This week on Cracked Science, three kinds of lies: lies, damn lies, and some forms of nonverbal communication. Hey, this is Jonathan Jarre, and you're watching Cracked Science, the show from the McGill Office for Science and Society that separates sense from nonsense on the scientific stage. Hollywood is obsessed with crime-solving brainiacs who use science and observations to serve justice. And in 2009, we were introduced to this addition to the lot.
Maybe you want one of the smaller churches, one of the black suburbs.
You know what you're talking about.
Don't respond. What do you say ATF starts with Southbridge?
Nah, I'm only kidding. We're gonna skip that one. We're gonna focus on Lawton. You feel good about that?
That's it, Lawton. Going after a church in Lawton.
That accusation has no basis.
What do you mean? You just told me.
If this guy existed for real, I would love to see him take over from Maury Povich. Your face leaked a smile for a quarter of a second. You are not the father! What we just saw is the opening scene from Lie to Me, a show that tried to make nonverbal communication sexy and exciting. Nonverbal communication is a substantial field of research, and it encompasses everything from eye contact to posture to shrugs and waves, and even to the pants you're wearing, or not wearing, as you're watching this video at home. You thought I didn't know, but I can tell because I'm a master of nonverbal communication. Now, a small part of this field is devoted to detecting lies, but it is obviously where many people's interests lie, no pun intended. While there is a scientific consensus on lie detection, it bears little resemblance to what we see on TV. If Lie to Me was scientifically accurate, experts should be much better at catching lies than you and me. However, that's not really what we see. If you were to flip a coin to determine if statements I make are truthful or a lie, you would be right 50% of the time on average. Ordinary people, when asked to make this determination based on speech and behavior alone, they're not much better. On average, they're right 54% of the time, and this is based on over 120 studies involving 25,000 participants. What about experts? In real-world police interviews, they get, at best, to 65%. Imagine if for your colonoscopy, the gastroenterologist would only find the right hole 65% of the time. You'd be outraged and really confused. That's because the field of lie detection has failed to find simple answers. And the simplest answer to lie detection would look something like this.
I was going to school till I met somebody.
Met somebody?
Yeah. Two big monsters with big green eyes.
You may think I'm being silly, but for decades, experts in the field were indeed looking for the equivalent of Pinocchio's nose, the holy grail of lie detection. Since the 1960s, scientists in nonverbal communication explored what forms the basis of the TV show Lie to Me, which is leakage theory. The idea is that our body betrays our thoughts for a fraction of a second, and that if we pay close attention, we can spot these signs. On the face, these are known as microexpressions, and the character Tim Roth plays on Lie to Me would have us believe they are 100% reliable.
Now, I call out that this target is actually Lawton, and watch it again. Concealed scorn. One personal tip, you see this microexpression in your spouse's face, your marriage is coming to an end. Trust me.
This kind of unabashed confidence is completely unfounded, because scientists have failed to find Pinocchio's nose. Which, now that I say it like this, sounds like an Easter egg hunt where the kids looked inside mommy and daddy's night table and a family-friendly explanation was needed. You found Pinocchio's nose, now put it back, put it back! What I mean is that after 60 years of research, we can say that scientists have not found one facial expression or one gesture, nor a combination of any of these, that is never present when someone is honest, but always there when someone deceives. The nose of Pinocchio remains the stuff of fairy tales. Now, this video would be over if people simply looked at the body of evidence on the matter, shrugged, and went, all right. But of course, we're talking about humans here, so you know the story is about to become truly horrifying. The real subject of this video, and yes, this means I've been lying to you this whole time and you couldn't tell, is the difference between science and pseudoscience. Pseudo comes from the Greek, which means false or fake. Pseudoscience looks like science on the outside, but it's not actual science. And there is a pseudoscience of nonverbal communication, particularly when it comes to lie detection. And its reach is far wider and worrisome than you might expect. There are myths about lie detection that persist. For example, you may believe that someone who's looking away from you when answering your question is lying. If you do, you're in good company. Here's what a judge of the Superior Court of Quebec wrote. Having carefully observed the accused during his testimony and noted his great nervousness, his fleeting glare, and his numerous hesitations in cross-examination, the undersigned is convinced that the accused has simply forged his version of the facts according to the evidence disclosed, and that he thereby lied to the court in a shameless manner. The uh-oh moment comes when we realize that a fleeting glare is not a reliable indicator of a lie. It's not Pinocchio's nose. In fact, it can often be caused by embarrassment. If you've ever caught your dog chewing your sofa, you know that the truth can also be embarrassing. Ditto for nervousness and hesitation. Honest people can be nervous and hesitate. Nose scratching is another myth of lie detection. It has nothing to do with deception. The problem is when people in positions of power believe these myths and make important decisions based on them. These kinds of myths and many more unreliable indicators of state of mind have become institutionalized by pseudoscientists. Take synergology. Synergology is an influential and legitimate-looking discipline that claims to teach you how to decode nonverbal communication. Learning synergology ain't cheap. The 15 weekends you'll need will cost you nearly $7,000. For less than twice that amount, you can come to McGill and get a bachelor's degree in an actual science. Because how synergology came up with its 1,000 plus gestures and what they mean is pretty unscientific. Its founder looked at videos of people appearing on talk shows and made associations between their gestures and what he believed to be their state of mind. Yes, I kid you not, none of this is based on actual experiments with participants, which is what an experimental psychologist would do. It's all based on videos and on guessing what the person was thinking of at the time. And none of these associations are peer-reviewed, and this is where the rubber meets the road. One of the fundamental principles of actual science is that it is open to criticism. Your peers, meaning other scientists in your field, get to see your results in a scientific journal, and they can try to replicate your experiments. And even before your results are published, fellow scientists get to read your article and correct you on bad methodology and bad statistics. And believe me, they do, some with the apparent pleasure of an executioner chopping your head off with a butter knife. Hold still, this is going to take a while. Synergology, though it has existed for 30 years, has no such foundation in peer review. You may think, well, who cares how bored rich people spend their money? How does this affect me? It does, because these unscientific notions have spread to the minds of cops, lawyers, and judges in Quebec. According to an article by La Presse columnist Patrick Lagacé, two online training modules in synergology were viewed 3,000 times on the website of the Quebec Bar Association, training which gives lawyers continued education credits. One training included the true or false question, synergology is based on a rigorous scientific methodology. The answer, of course, is true. Some judges from the Superior Court of Quebec have also been trained in the pseudoscience. And this web of influence gets larger. On the website of the consulting firm of Christine Gagnon, the co-founder of the Quebec Institute of Synergology, we see a long list of some of her clients. And the names you see scrolling on your screen should give you pause. The website lists testimonials from the Association of Certified Fraud Examiners, a recruitment center for the Canadian Armed Forces, and the Montreal Police, among others. She also offers this pseudoscientific knowledge to counter terrorism. You may think, okay, if synergology is a pseudoscience, using it to detect terrorists is a bad idea, but at least airport security is using genuine nonverbal communication science to detect these threats. Are they? After 9/11, the United States Transport Security Administration started to employ thousands of what they call behavior detection officers to identify passengers who look suspicious. What they were looking for were things like, and I am not making this up, how a passenger swallows, or the degree to which their eyes are open. Unsurprisingly, a damning report from the Government Accountability Office came out last July that looked at what these officers' training was based on. It was based on 178 sources. Of these, 137, meaning 77%, were news or opinion sources, not scientific papers. In fact, they found that 98% of the sources do not provide valid evidence applicable to these specific indicators that TSA identified them as supporting. You may be wondering by now if there is any validity to lie detection, and there is, though it's not as deterministic as we'd like it to be. One clue is in the mental effort needed to lie. If we ask you to tell your story backwards, you can have a harder time if it's a lie than if it really happened. Using such strategies during investigative interviews, along with specific types of questions, can enhance the lie detection accuracy of investigators. But as much as we'd like to believe, and despite what many people in positions of power have been told, there's no such thing as this.
Met somebody?
Yeah, two big monsters with big green eyes.
My recommendation this week is a video I made over a year ago when I attended a seminar on synergology. It goes into many more details, including claims made by its founder, comments from a fellow attendee, and the 1 hour, yes, 1 hour, he and I spent debating synergologists after the talk. The video is called Lie to Me Synergology, and you can find it on YouTube by searching Lie to Me Synergology, or find the link in this video's description if you're watching on YouTube. Our office at McGill now releases a weekly email newsletter, so if you don't want to miss all the new and exciting content we produce regularly, go to mcgill.ca/OSS and click on the giant red box to subscribe. If you like what I do and want to follow me on Twitter, I'm at Cracked Science, and I will see you soon with more Cracked Science.